So the title of my talk is, Yes, Humans Really Are Causing Earthquakes. And I've titled it this way to disabuse you of any notion that any of the these earthquakes or the big earthquake rate increase that we're seeing is natural. We are causing earthquakes. We are causing lots of earthquakes. And I mentioned in the trivia questions, the largest earthquake that we know to have been caused by human activity was a couple of magnitude 7s. There's actually debate about whether magnitude 7.8 in China in 2008 was actually caused by the filling of the reservoir. So we can cause very big earthquakes. But what I'll really be focusing on today is the earthquake rate increase that we've been seeing in the central United States. Oklahoma is far ahead of California when it comes to magnitude 3 and larger earthquakes. I just found this up here that it's a Photoshop of Welcome to Oklahoma, and I thought it was pretty entertaining. On the right-hand side, what we're just looking at, the graph is just showing you a cumulative count of earthquakes since 1973 in the central United States. And what you see is in about 2009, things sort of started taking off. And you know, there have been far more earthquakes just in the past 7 years than there were in the preceding 30. But so humans really are causing earthquakes, but it's probably not in the way you think. It is neither Max Zorin nor Lex Luthor, I got those reversed, trying to cause earthquakes in the Bay Area in either Superman or A View to a Kill, both excellent movies, perhaps appeal to the seismologist in me, although both of them are trying to destroy the Bay Area, which is where I live, so I'm a little disappointed. Actually, really impressively, the Superman movie, more or less the way Lex Luthor is trying to cause earthquakes is the exact way that people are causing earthquakes now. So 1979, they were really ahead of their time. So what I really want to do is sort of walk you through the history of man-made earthquakes or induced earthquakes. And what I mean by induced is earthquakes that have been caused by human activities. I may use the word triggered. I use these a little bit interchangeably. It's basically an earthquake that would not have happened were it not for these human activities. So walk you through a little bit of the history. We'll talk about oil and gas processes, and then we'll go through a couple of the recent case studies and what is going on now in the research areas, and you know, what does the future hold for us. So the first known induced earthquakes happened in 1894 in Johannesburg itself. Johannesburg was started as a mining town, a very active gold mining, and basically they were using room and pillar mining. Just what it sounds like. They basically excavate a room and leave these pillars. And there were big collapses and actually caused failure on faults within this area. And so this shaking was actually felt within, you know, at the time, more or less a village of Johannesburg, South Africa. And shortly thereafter, and these were recognized as human-caused earthquakes, shortly thereafter, in 1908, in Bochum, Germany, Germans actually started the first seismological laboratory specifically to study man-made earthquakes. And just a dozen years later, there was actually a seismic network deployed in the Silesia Coal Basin, which is in Poland, to actually monitor these earthquakes. So this is a very well-known phenomenon that's actually been studied for over a century. Things have just heated up again very recently. And so it's not just mining. Oil production has been associated with induced earthquakes for a very, very long time. This is a photo of Goose Creek. This is about an hour away from Houston, right on the Gulf Coast. Looks like a real charming vacation spot. There are just oil derricks everywhere. And basically what was happening here is they're extracting so much oil here that you're starting to see collapse features. And as far as I know, these are the only earthquakes who have ever been felt in Houston. Then people started discovering earthquakes due to reservoir filling. This is a photo from just a few years ago, and so you can see how low Lake Mead is. But when they started filling Lake Mead in the early 1930s, people started feeling earthquakes nearby. They deployed a seismic network, and they saw that earthquakes were happening just below this reservoir. So human-caused earthquakes actually have a very long and rich history, and there are many different ways that we have caused earthquakes in the past. Now, there are a number of sort of characteristics of induced earthquakes that we sort of think of. You know, generally, these earthquakes are going to be close to sort of the man-made activity that causes these earthquakes. So it's going to be close to the oil and gas operations. It's going to be close to the mining operation in general. And then we also think of things going to be close in time. You know, when you shortly after you start the reservoir, or shortly after you start exploring for oil and gas. And again, we also think that these earthquakes are generally, they're going to be close to the surface. They're going to be close to where we're causing these changes, because pretty much all the activities that we're going to be doing are close to the Earth's surface. Well, these are not hard and fast rules, not by a long shot. I can provide you examples that violate every single one of these rules. So these are sort of good guidelines to sort of start thinking about whether earthquakes are being caused by human activities. But these aren't really criteria that you can specifically use. So why is it that these man-made earthquakes are suddenly an issue? Well, the earthquake rate, as I showed you on that first slide, unfortunately we're cut off right here, we're looking at an annual count of magnitude 3 larger earthquakes in the central United States, sort of averaging around here about 20 or 30 or so a year. You know, earthquakes cluster, so you see some variability. And then in about 2009, things start ramping up. And you can see in last year we had over 1,000 magnitude 3 and larger earthquakes. And this is the projected rate for 2016 as of a couple of days ago. So we're still over 800, but there is a drop in the earthquake rate. But we're still seeing an incredible amount of earthquakes in these places that are totally unexpected. You know, the earthquake rate has increased by a factor of 40 in the central United States. And it's not just magnitude 3s. We're starting to see larger earthquakes. We're starting to see damaging earthquakes. And these are just a couple of photos from the two largest injection-related earthquakes that we've seen. Damage from the 5.3 Trinidad, Colorado earthquake. You can see that this was a storage facility. It was an unreinforced masonry building, much like this building, which are pretty much the least safe buildings to be in an earthquake. But you can see more or less it just lost its facade. And then this is, again, a masonry building that was damaged by the magnitude 5.6 Prague earthquake. Yes, that is how they say it in Oklahoma. So, you know, it's not just an earthquake rate change. It's also the earthquake distribution is very, very different. Now, I've plotted on the left-hand side a map of the magnitude 3 and larger earthquakes from 1973 to 2008, and then 2009 till just a couple of days ago. Now, there are three times as many earthquakes on this as there are on here, but the distribution is nothing like each other. You can see there's a real high density here in Oklahoma, sort of looks like Texas kind of has the chicken pox, and there's a few other spots here, and there's some diffuse seismicity, but it's nothing like what we see over here with our seismicity more or less everywhere. You know, you do see some hot spots here like the New Madrid seismic zone, the Eastern Tennessee shear zone. These are all areas of natural seismicity, but you don't see this, in particular, this high density of seismicity here in Oklahoma that we really see right here. So, as I mentioned, there were an average of 24 earthquakes a year from 74 to 2008, and now we're up to 345 a year just in the last 7 years, but if you look just last year, we're over 1,000. So the earthquake rate is increasing still. And as a Californian, I'm perhaps a little bit jealous of Oklahoma. They got a lot more earthquakes than we do. So what's shown here is just a count, again, of 3 larger earthquakes. And I keep coming back to magnitude 3 and larger, and that's just sort of the threshold at which we're certain, more or less certain, that we have all of the earthquakes. We're not missing earthquakes. And so we're just looking at an annual count of 3 larger earthquakes in California, shown in blue, Oklahoma in red. You can see we're really dominating them from 1990 till 2013 here. These spikes are related to larger earthquakes. This is the Hector Mine earthquake in the desert. This is the Northridge earthquake, magnitude 6.7, that caused a lot of damage in Los Angeles. This is the Landers earthquake, again, in the desert. And this is the, I forgot the name, right on the border with Mexico, this is an earthquake here. So that's what these spikes are. These are earthquakes, larger earthquakes in their aftershock sequences. Oklahoma's rattling on about 1, 2, 3 magnitude 3s until 2009. And as you can see, they're far ahead of California now. And I've projected the earthquake rates for California and Oklahoma, and you can see they're well in the lead again for 2016. So I just want to show you an animation. What's up? Show you an animation of what the seismicity looks like in Oklahoma from 2008 forward, the dots are going to be showing you the locations of the earthquakes, sort of as a function of time. And what you'll note at the beginning, it's a pretty boring video. Not a lot of earthquakes popping up, but you will see things start to accelerate shortly. Things are starting to pick up in November of 2011. There's going to be a large earthquake at 5.6, and that's really when things start heating up. And it gets more exciting, don't worry. You'll start looking up here to the north to the Hutton dewatering play, as well as the Mississippi Lime up here, coming up pretty much any second. And you can see things are radically different. It's pretty incredible. You know, I knew that this earthquake rate was really, really dramatic. A question I get a lot is, you know, Justin, how are all these earthquakes occurring in Oklahoma? You know, are there any faults there? Well, actually, there's pretty much faults everywhere, and Oklahoma has a lot of faults. This is a preliminary fault map released by the Oklahoma Geological Survey last year, and this was really produced in collaboration with a lot of industry partners there. Industry really came to the table and provided a lot of information on faults. You know, they know about faults because it's important to understand the geology of their oil and gas fields that they're operating. So they know a lot of these. And if you looked at the geologic map of Oklahoma a year before, you probably would have seen about 10 faults on this map. So this really has shown, you know, how much industry really has come to the table on this issue. And so there are lots of opportunities, lots of different places where you can have earthquakes. So, and just like in Oklahoma, there's more or less lots of faults everywhere, just like you would see here in Oregon as well. Now I want to come back to the rate increase just briefly. You know, you really see that the big increase is in Oklahoma, but the increase is, there is an increase elsewhere, and it's limited to just a few areas. So we're looking at a cumulative count again of three and larger earthquakes, and what I'm going to do, so this is cumulative, this is not rate, and so this ramping upward is just showing that there's more and more earthquakes. If it was constant rate, it'd just be a line going across here. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to sort of select out areas of active oil and gas, and you'll see this dropping down. So we subtract out Oklahoma, and we're almost back to our straight line already. I can subtract out, this is the Guy-Greenbrier sequence in Arkansas. We'll drop down a little bit more. Subtract out the Raton Basin. This is an area that I've studied. It drops even further. We can subtract out a couple of other areas in Texas, as well as in New Mexico, and we're back to our average earthquake rate for pool. So what this is really showing us is that the earthquake rate change that we're seeing in the central United States is limited to just a few different areas, and all of these areas are areas of known and new seismicity. So what is it that is actually causing these earthquakes? We've got the answer in the trivia is wastewater disposal, but I want to walk you through all of the different oil and gas techniques and how they might cause these earthquakes. So first, what we're looking at here is a picture of a frack job, hydraulic fracturing, which I'm guessing just about everybody picked as the source of most of these earthquakes. The largest earthquake that hydraulic fracturing has been associated with, and this is really actually hotly under debate, is a magnitude 4.6. I think the most compelling evidence that I've seen is for a 3.6. You know, maybe it could be larger, but right now hydraulic fracturing has been linked to a 4.6. And you can see it's a pretty impressive operation. Oil production, so this is just oil and gas extraction. It was linked to two magnitude 7s in Uzbekistan in the late 1970s and early 1980s. So this has produced some very, very large earthquakes. Wastewater disposal, which is our problem child, not a particularly impressive operation. Caused the magnitude 5.6 Prague, Oklahoma earthquake. This is a photo of a wastewater well that I visited in Weld County, just to the north of Denver, Colorado. And the last is enhanced oil recovery. The largest earthquake that it's been linked to is a magnitude 4.5. So how is it that these operations cause earthquakes? Basically, you can cause earthquakes through fluid injection in two different ways. I'll first talk about the way that we really don't think is related to the earthquakes, and focus on the second one. So what we think is happening is with fluid injection or extraction, you're taking out or adding a lot of mass. And so basically, if you're adding a lot of mass, you're taking out mass, you're changing stress conditions, you're changing the weight on everything below it and also to the sides. And so if you're adding weight, you're going to be pressing down on this ball. And so you've changed the stress conditions that this fault is experiencing. And so this may be more or less the straw that broke the camel's back that sort of pushed it into failure. Now, generally, this isn't what we see as being responsible for these earthquakes or for injection-related earthquakes. You know, production-related earthquakes, this is the primary mechanism. By sort of pulling this load of all of this oil off, you've sort of started to unclamp this fault. You know, it's being pressed closed by the weight of all this rock above, and it's not being pressed closed, it's a little bit easier for it to slip. What we think is responsible for most of the earthquakes related to fluid injection is actually the effect of fluid pressure. Basically, you've got this well here, you inject, and well, most of the time it goes in and you never hear from it again. Every once in a while, though, there's hydraulic connectivity between this injection layer and a fault. And so the fluid gets into the fault and more or less pries it open. And again, just like this, you're sort of, you're reducing the amount of resistance. You're prying this fault open a little bit, making it easier for it to slip. You've reduced the amount of friction preventing that fault from slipping. And so again, it's more or less the straw that broke the camel's back in that these faults are very close to failure. This is just sort of makes it easier for these to fail. So I want to walk you through hydraulic fracturing and wastewater disposal because these are sort of the two ones that everybody thinks about. First off, it is much older than probably everybody thinks. It was invented nearly 70 years ago. It is an incredibly impressive operation. I've visited a couple of frac sites. You can see that there's piping going absolutely everywhere. You can't see, but typically they have sort of two trailers worth of control rooms filled with hundreds of thousands of dollars of computer equipment. It's really quite an operation. And there's also a whole lot of water. This is just a line of a few water tanker trucks. There were probably about 100 at this frac site that I went to. So it's a very impressive and expensive operation. And in some sense, they are intentionally causing earthquakes. They're making very, very small earthquakes, magnitude minus 2, magnitude 1. Nobody's going to feel these earthquakes. Nobody will. And what it really is you're injecting at high pressure with the intention of increasing permeability. By putting water into high pressure, you sort of break this rock open, and it means that you can sort of reach these more shaded areas than you would have before. What we're looking at here is just sort of a side cut looking into the earth, what is a horizontal well. And you can see it's been fractured in all of these areas, and so you're able to access any oil or gas that's in this area. Now, frac jobs are very, very short duration. These are going to be lasting hours, maybe a couple days at the very, very biggest. And they inject about 60,000 barrels of well. On average, some are much bigger, some are much smaller. For those of you, since it's pub night, there's about 2 kegs per barrel. To put that in perspective, there's a lot of drinking. And one important thing to clarify, there is no such thing as a hydraulic fracturing well. This is a production well. This is a well that you are extracting oil and gas out. You frack the well, then you suck the frack fluid out, and you start pulling out oil. You've just pressured this up to break open these rocks so you can access more oil. But the real problem is these saltwater disposal wells. So first, I should probably clarify, what is this saltwater? What is wastewater? And frac fluid certainly is part of this. Generally, oil and gas companies want to reuse frac fluid because it's expensive. So if they can, they will. Sometimes it's too contaminated and they need to dispose of it. But the real source of most of the salt water, most of the wastewater, is what's known as co-produced water. And co-produced water is just water that comes up with oil and gas. When you're pulling up the oil, it comes with it. It's not a choice. Oil is basically the decomposition of biological material in relict oceans. And so that has sort of turned into oil, and you still have all of this even saltier water that's hanging out with it. And so it just comes up with it. And so, generally, if they can clean it up, they will. Discharge it on the surface, use it for agriculture, but oftentimes it's very, very salty. In parts of Oklahoma, it can be 300,000 parts per million salt. So far, far saltier than the ocean. It's not really something that you can deal with. And so you have to inject this into a deeper reservoir. And so that's what wastewater disposal is you drill a deeper well. So this is now our production well. We've fracked it. You can see here, you're pulling out oil and gas in this sort of yellow. And this is our waste fluid in blue. You either truck it or take it by pipeline to a disposal well. and you inject it, that's probably right away. You inject it in here, and most of the time, like I mentioned, doesn't really cause any problems. So let's compare wastewater disposal and hydraulic fracturing, and I'll explain to you, sort of show to you why it is that wastewater disposal is far more important when it comes to earthquakes than hydraulic fracturing. Now I told you hydraulic fracturing is a very short-term process. You're going to do it over a few hours, maybe a few days. And it's pretty low volume, sort of a big frac job is 100,000 barrels. So a lot of kegs of beer, not a lot of them. And there are about 1 million wells or so that have been fracked in the United States to date. Wastewater disposal, on the other hand, is a very long-term process. It's going on for years or even decades. And it can be very high volume. Some of these wells are injecting 1 million barrels a month. And they can be operating for decades. And some of these wells have injected 1 billion barrels of water. So you're putting in a whole lot. And there's about 35,000 of these wells. And if you sort of combine the long-term injection and the amount of water that's going in wastewater, you have a much larger exposure area. The volume of water is going to be affecting a much larger area. And the pressures are going to be affecting the area for a much longer period of time because you're injecting for a much longer period of time. And so you could expect reasonably that wastewater disposal is going to cause more earthquakes because you're affecting a larger area over a much longer period of time than you are with a frac job. And that's more or less what we actually see. There are many, many felt earthquakes associated with wastewater disposal, many damaging earthquakes, and very few felt earthquakes associated with fracking, and as far as I know, no damaging earthquakes. So this, you know, if you take anything away from this talk, please take this away. Fracking is not the evil thing, at least when it comes to this perspective. We can get into fluid contamination at a later date. I'm a seismologist, not a chemist. So what's really changed? You know, I've just told you that wastewater disposal is an old process. I told you hydraulic fracturing is an old process. Why are we suddenly seeing all of these earthquakes? Well, what's changed is drilling technology, but it's not fracking. It's not wastewater disposal. It's they've now been able to start steering wells. Traditionally, wells are more or less vertical, and so you're going to produce some amount of wastewater. And let's just say you produce a kiddie pool's worth of wastewater, just for fun. But now, once you have a horizontally drilled well, and this is actually very, very difficult, and they've really only developed the technology in the last 10 or 15 years, when you start drilling horizontal wells, you can now start exploiting reservoirs that were not economical with just a vertical well. You're able to pull out enough oil when you go horizontal that you can now access many other areas. And these areas are often very resource poor, so the ratio of oil to water is much lower. And so now, instead of a kiddie pool, you now have an Olympic-sized swimming pool. You're more or less producing 10 times more water from horizontal wells than you are from these vertical wells. So you're producing way more water than you need to get rid of. So that's really the source of this increased earthquake rate that we're seeing, is we're now able to access these sort of poorer resources that produce much more salt water, so there's much more salt water disposal. So now I want to tell you a little bit about the history of induced earthquakes, go through a couple of case studies. We first discovered induced earthquakes related to injection in the 1960s. Just outside of Denver, there's a place called the Rocky Mountain Arsenal. They were producing chemical weapons there. As you might expect, there's going to be a lot of nasty chemicals that you've got to get rid of. And so what they did is they drilled a deep well, they drilled into crystalline basement. So they're out of all the sedimentary formations. They're in really hard rock. And they just started pumping away. And a few months later, people started feeling earthquakes in Denver. And it actually, you know, it's an interesting detective story. It took them about 6 months to actually make the connection between these earthquakes and the fluid injection. And if you just look at this, you know, we're looking at the number of earthquakes recorded near this injection well. And this is just the millions of gallons of injected into that well. And you can see that sort of you start injecting, the earthquakes turn on. You stop injection, so they actually stopped injecting for about a year. The earthquakes turn off, start injecting, earthquakes come back. This is a pretty obvious connection that you can make. Now, an important thing to take away. There's two important things to take away from this. These earthquakes are being caused by this fluid injection, but they aren't always all that close. So we're looking here at a side cut of the seismicity, and we're looking now in 1967. They stopped injecting in 1966. And you can see all of these dots here are earthquakes, and none of these earthquakes are within 3 miles. So this is showing us these earthquakes don't have to be right on top of the well. This is the point of injection. The other really important point to take away is this is 1967. We're now full year after injection has stopped, and these earthquakes are still going. In fact, the largest earthquake to occur at the Rocky Mountain Arsenal occurred 1 year after. It was a magnitude 4.9 earthquake. So it's not necessary that just by shutting off the well, you're able to shut off these earthquakes. So the other sort of historical study that I want to mention was some work actually done by some USGS scientists. There's Barry Raleigh, Jack Healy, and John Breedahoff, who are all scientists in the Menlo Park office in the Bay Area where I work. And they managed to convince Chevron somehow to give them control over part of their field. And they wanted to say, you know, is this really just the fluid pressure that's causing these earthquakes? Can we turn the earthquakes off? And so they had control of these four wells. We're looking at a side cut, because up here, these are map view. So you can see there's 1, 2, 3, 4 injection wells here. They're injecting into the sandstone formation. All of the dots are earthquakes. And so this is a 6-month period of co-injection during the injection, and this is a 1-year period after injection. And so they're pumping fluid in, and you can see there's a whole lot of earthquakes. There's a whole lot of earthquakes. So the earthquakes are turning on as they're pumping this water in. After the injection is stopped, they actually try to return the reservoir back to its natural state. They return the fluid pressure back to what it was before it was ever disturbed by the oil and gas activity. And now you can see in a year's time, there's very, very few earthquakes. And so more or less, in a year's time versus 6 months, there's, you know, far less earthquakes than there are here. So this was really a very clean demonstration that fluid pressure is the source of these earthquakes. And this really is a landmark study for our field. And, you know, really nothing has been able to replicate this in the past 40 years since, because it's very expensive to drill wells, and it's hard to convince oil companies to give us control of their wells as well. So next I want to talk about what I think is one of the best studied, most exhaustively studied earthquake sequences. And this is an earthquake sequence in the exurbs of Dallas, which is the Azle earthquake. So Dallas is way over here. Here's Fort Worth. You know, we're about 20, 30 miles away from Fort Worth. It was a series of largest, I think the largest earthquake was a magnitude 3.6 earthquake. And you can see this is what's called a Did You Feel It map. Basically, you can go to earthquake.usgs.gov. You can find the earthquake and tell us how you felt that earthquake. And this will wind up into maps just like this. And this is actually very useful information for us to understand how shaking intensity varies across any given area. So you can see this was actually felt over a very wide area, you know, over 50, 60 miles in any given direction. So one really important point when thinking about induced earthquakes, and these earthquakes, like we talked about, they're occurring in Oklahoma, they're occurring in Texas, they're occurring in Kansas. These are not places where we have a whole lot of seismometers. You know, we've generally been studying earthquakes where they happen. That's where we have the seismometers. And you really need to have seismometers to be close so that you can locate them very well. And so what we're looking at is a map. This is about 4 miles here, so this is probably a 20, 30 mile across. These are now locations of earthquakes using just the backbone USGS network. From this Azle earthquake sequence, you can see they're all over the map. Now, we actually, in response to this earthquake sequence, we went out and put out a number of more instruments so that we could better locate these earthquakes. And so now when we use those, they collapse down to a point. And so this really shows you the limitations of seismometry, is that we really need more data to actually be able to study this. And, you know, without this instrumentation, there's absolutely nothing that we could say about this scientifically. You know, we've got a spread of 10 or 15 miles in any given direction from where the earthquakes are. So it's really necessary to have stations that are close. So in a study that was published last year by Matt Hornbach and some colleagues from Southern Methodist University as well as the USGS, they tried to understand why there were earthquakes near Basel, and they really went through basically the entire list of ways that these earthquakes could be caused. Were they caused naturally? Are they natural earthquakes? Or are they water level changes in Eagle Mountain Lake? You can see this is the outline of Eagle Mountain Lake. There's a reservoir here. Is it due to water table decline? This is in the area of time of massive drought in Texas. Was it due to production? This is Texas. There's oil and gas production just about everywhere. Was it due to the drawdown of these oil and gas reservoirs, or was it wastewater disposal? So they really wanted to try to understand everything. And so this is just sort of a geologic side cut looking at the area. These are where the earthquakes are occurring on this fault. This is the aquifer that they're injecting into. Here's the oil and gas reservoir. And so the first thing that they did is they said, all right, let's test whether or not it's lake level changes. So they first looked at, this is the level of the Eagle Mountain Lake. You can see it's decreasing. The earthquakes occurred about here. And so the lake level is actually very, very low. There were other times where there was little lake levels, but this really appears to be the longest period where lake levels were low. So they computed sort of the stress changes at the depth where the earthquakes were occurring. And this is a map view here, the dots showing you where the earthquakes occurred. This outline is showing you the map, and you can see basically there's no stress changes unless you're right under this reservoir. So we can cross off the list that it's lake level changes. So next they considered, maybe it's oil production. So this is a map showing you how impressive oil and gas can be. Every one of these lines is an oil and gas well. There's a lot happening in the area. And there's also a couple high volume waste disposal levels. And basically what they did is they examined, they combined the effects of the wastewater disposal and the production to look at what the stresses would be like on the fault where they had that they had inferred based upon the seismicity. And so they computed the stresses sort of as a function of time. The earthquake started in December 2013. And so here the locations of the two injection wells, they had not yet been turned on until 2010. You can see just the effects of the production. And you sort of go through time and the stresses start getting bigger. And you can see here now are all the earthquakes sort of lying at sort of the low of the high stresses. So I think this is sort of a pretty nice demonstration that they were able to show that these earthquakes were caused by, they believe actually a combination of fluid production as well as injection. So the next study that I want to mention is actually one that I was involved in that I think is a pretty exciting study. Incredible amount of work really taken on by a graduate student at University of Colorado. And he gathered all the information about every oil and gas injection well in the central and eastern United States. And so he plotted them here. And there are 27,000 or so active saltwater disposal wells. Here you can see the saltwater disposal well density. And so you can see they're sort of focused again, as you might expect, in Kansas, Oklahoma, Texas. And he also took all the enhanced oil recovery wells. These are another kind of injection wells. And you can see that they're often lying in the same sort of places, but you're also finding in other places where you don't have wastewater disposal wells. And so we wanted to understand, what are the parameters, what are the injection parameters that might control whether or not you're going to be causing earthquakes. So we took a survey, basically took the entire USGS catalog of earthquakes from 1973 through 2014. And so we plotted those earthquakes here and we said, all right, are these earthquakes close to an injection well at the time that well was injected? And well, we came up with a lot of earthquakes. You can see there's a whole lot of different areas where there's earthquakes that have been associated with injection wells. And this is an important point that I need to clarify. We're not specifically saying that these earthquakes are being caused by these injection wells, but there's a possibility. All of these other wells, these are at least 15 kilometers or 10 miles away from injection wells, and the likelihood that they are being induced by injection wells. But what we really, like I said, what we really wanted to understand is what are the parameters of fluid injection that make it more likely to cause earthquakes. So we turned this on its head and said, we started to plot. Now we're looking at the active injection wells, and we've colored in yellow the injection wells that are associated with earthquakes. And now we can start take a look at this and starting to notice a couple of really interesting patterns. You can see here in Oklahoma, it's covered in wells, but there's really only sort of this central Oklahoma region that has wells that are associated with earthquakes, where there's a lot of Oklahoma, a lot of Kansas that has lots of injection, but no earthquakes. So what is the difference between these two? You can also go here up to North Dakota. Almost none of these wells have any earthquakes associated with them. You can look at Central Michigan, and there's absolutely no earthquakes that are associated. So, you know, this is a question that we're trying to understand is, you know, what makes Michigan different from Oklahoma and Kansas, that they don't have the earthquakes despite the fact they have lots of injection. And if you look now, you know, I showed you previously that if you sort of subtract out all the earthquakes from oil and gas areas, you get back to your same earthquake rate. And so that's more or less what this plot is. Once more, shown in gray is the background earthquake rate. Shown in red are associated earthquakes, so earthquakes that could potentially be induced. And this black line going up on the bottom is sort of the number of non-associated earthquakes. And so by subtracting out all the associated earthquakes, your earthquake rate is more or less constant, you know, even though we have had a 40-fold increase in the earthquake rate. So the obvious question is, you know, maybe we just have more wells. Maybe we have more injection wells now, and that's what's causing this. That's not actually the case. This is just a number of injection wells that were completed each year, and you can see, you know, we are in a period of high number of wells that have been drilled, but we had similarly high periods of drilling, and there wasn't really a significant change. And so it doesn't appear just that it's a specific, just the number of wells. There's something a little more complex. So sort of the two parameters that people really think about that could be affecting whether or not a well induces earthquakes are the injection rate and the total injected volume. And so what we did is we counted all of our wells and sort of binned them up by injection rate or cumulative injection volume and said what percentage of these wells are associated with earthquakes, what percentage of these wells are within 15 kilometers of earthquake. And so we're just going across here, maximum injection rate. We're more or less sort of staying right in this average of 41% or so of these wells. But at about 100,000, 200,000 barrels a month, we start turning upwards. And now at a million barrels a month, a good 90% of the wells injecting at a million barrels a month are associated with earthquakes. And these red lines are just showing you confidence balance, where if you're falling outside of these, it is statistically improbable that what you're seeing is random. And so we can pretty confidently say when you're injecting over 100, 200,000 barrels a month, the probability of inducing an earthquake is higher. But if we look at total injected volume, you can see that we more or less rattle around sort of in between these values the entire way. So it does not appear that the total injected volume really has a significant control on whether you're going to be inducing earthquakes. Now we also explored a couple of other parameters. We looked at proximity to basement, so how close you're injecting to this competent hard rock that can actually really sustain the stress needed to produce an earthquake. And we saw no real correlation, except for the very, very, the areas where the basement is so far down, there's just no communication. When the basement is very, very far down, we don't see anything. But if you're within 5 or 6 kilometers, it doesn't matter the depth of injection. We don't see any connection between injection pressure and whether or not you're having earthquakes, which again is something we were really surprised by, but there's another thing that we really can't control for, which is the geologic factors. This is just something that we just don't have a good handle on. We need to know, you know, what are the stresses in the area? What is the fault distribution? Now, I showed you the fault map for Oklahoma. There's far more faults than we ever could have known of. And so, are there faults there? Are there faults large enough, long enough to produce earthquakes? And are these faults oriented appropriately within the stress field to actually produce an earthquake? So finally, I want to sort of leave you with an outlook. I think things aren't all doom and gloom. You know, we are still seeing lots and lots of earthquakes, but we can't seem to control induced earthquakes, at least to some degree. You know, we saw in the Rangeley experiment, the USGS scientists were able to turn earthquakes off and on, you know, just with the fluid pressure. So there is a way to control it. We've also seen this in a couple of very other areas, Paradox Valley and the Mount of Trent. Regulators in a number of states have actually forced shutdowns of earthquakes, forced shutdowns of wells, and they have reduced earthquake rates. So this is something that is working. And there are a number of states that have considered or are enacting regulation. Sort of this cluster of five states here, which is where actually most of the induced earthquake action is really occurring, as well as Ohio and California, although California is shamefully only regulating hydraulic fracturing, despite the fact we've more or less given this lecture to them and said hydraulic fracturing is not most responsible for induced earthquakes. But people are actually taking action, and it is actually having an effect. You know, the decrease in the earthquake rate that we're observing in Oklahoma and Kansas is almost certainly due to these regulations, as well as the drop in the price of oil. Now, as you learned, the EPA is the responsible agency for regulating injection in the United States, and they have, in fact, released guidance on how to try to minimize induced earthquakes. So this is more a best practices document than anything else. It's not specific regulations. The EPA really has not fully gone after the induced seismicity issue. They left this sort of up to the states, because the states can choose to have more stringent regulations than set by the EPA. Now, the USGS, just a couple of months ago, we released a report, which is our first ever assessment for estimating induced earthquake hazard. This is a product the USGS has been producing for 30 years, which is an estimate of earthquake hazard. These are the things that are used to set earthquake insurance rates, for example. And we produce ground shaking hazard estimates for the entire country. But we had never actually assessed what the hazard was in these areas where we had seen induced earthquakes. And so what you're seeing is just sort of our first step, really, at doing this. This is something that really has been a collaborative process, both between us, the USGS, as well as other academic scientists. The oil industry has obviously been a participant, as well as our users, the people that are going to be using this, regulators, as well as Department of Transportation. Many people are actually using this to make some sorts of decisions. And so what we've done, instead of the forecast that we normally do for tectonic earthquakes are 30 or 50 years, we've now released a one-year shaking forecast. And so just over here, we computed the hazard, including induced earthquakes, and as you might expect, since Oklahoma is the leader in induced seismicity, that's where most of the hazard is. But if you don't include those, this is what the hazard looks like. So it's a pretty dramatic change in the hazard that we have now that we're starting to include induced seismicity in these estimates. And this is something that we're hoping to further develop new techniques for understanding hazard, because this is really new territory for us. So moving forward, you know, the high earthquake rate are continuing. They seem to be decreasing. It's probably a product of both economics, you know, price of oil is cratered, as well as the impact of new regulations. We haven't seen any extraordinarily large earthquakes. The biggest, as I mentioned, is approximately 6, but we shouldn't rule out the possibility that there could not be larger earthquakes. And we need to keep in mind earthquakes in the central U.S. are potentially much more dangerous than they are, say, here on the West Coast. Reason being is, you know, our construction standards are very different than they are in Oklahoma. We're built to withstand strong shaking, and they really aren't. And so we start seeing, you know, even in fives, five and a half, we start seeing significant damage in these earthquakes in Oklahoma. But I really do see, you know, there is a fair amount of hope. There has been a lot of cooperation between industry, academics, regulators, and the USGS to try to understand this problem. You know, nobody wants these earthquakes, and so if we can develop ways to mitigate these, it serves everybody. And, you know, really, really to do this, you know, really requires data share. And industry has a lot of data they don't necessarily share. We're slowly trying to tease this out of them. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. And I'm always going to say, as a scientist, I need more data. So more data, please. Finally, I just want to leave you with a couple of places where you can get some more information. There's copies of this article, hopefully still in the back. Please take them. That means I don't have to take them home. This article is just background information on induced seismicity. If you missed something in this talk, it's a pretty comprehensive, plain English explanation of induced seismicity. Also on the right is just a picture of the front page of our induced seismicity website, which you can find here. And I'll just leave you with an image. This presentation was actually brought to you by two different seismology professional organizations, the Incorporated Research Institutions for Seismology and the Seismological Society. Thanks.
Question, since Saudi Arabia is one of the largest producers of oil, and I don't hear a lot about earthquakes, is that because they are basically pressurized reservoirs under capstone? Is that
It's a good question. I don't know specifically about what is happening in Saudi Arabia. If I were to guess, what it is in Saudi Arabia, I think it's very high cut in that it's a very, very high percentage oil, not so much wastewater. And so what I would guess is that there's far less water that needs to be injected. That would be my guess, but I really don't know what's happening. No, so this is, you know, this oil comes from relict oceans. It's basically the decomposed biological components. And so this is old ocean, so it's just salty water that's from the ocean. So it typically winds up even saltier, you know, as the biological components are taken out of it.
Hi. I was really interested to see that the state legislatures and the regulations come from there. What about the insurance industry? Do you see any response from them or?
So the question's about the insurance industry. It is very interesting what is going on. In Oklahoma is really where most of the earthquakes are happening, and so that's where most is going on as far as insurance. The insurance commissioner in Oklahoma has actually advised homeowners to get earthquake insurance, but now many of the insurers are denying claims that for earthquakes that they believe are induced. So it's pretty complicated. There are now class action suits both in Oklahoma and Arkansas where people are suing the company that they believe are responsible for the earthquakes that caused the damage to their homes. So we'll see how it works out.
Yeah.
First one is the increase in earthquakes that you see, is how much of that might be related to the idea that we weren't able to switch back?
To answer your first question, no, it's not due to the fact that our monitoring capabilities have changed. We're able to detect more earthquakes now than we were before. You know, we intentionally choose this magnitude 3 threshold because we're pretty certain we've got all of the earthquakes. And if I raise that to 3.5, or I raise that to 4, we still see it. It's more remarkable when you see it at magnitude 3, just because the numbers are that much bigger. But it's not a detection capability. Good question.
This wastewater was pulled out of the wells, taken elsewhere, and put back into the ground. Why don't they just put it right back in the well and come out?
Well, so why don't they put it back in the well that they found it? Well, the short answer is that they do something like this in some sense. It's enhanced oil recovery or water, where they will inject into the same reservoir, not out of the same, not at the same well, but in other wells. They do do that at times, but in a lot of these reservoirs where it's very, very saline, where you're looking at 5% oil, you're causing more trouble than it's worth. You're actually reducing the ratio of oil to water, so you're gonna be throwing off more water, even more. And so it's not something that is done in these areas. They would do it if it was economical, if it made sense. And typically, enhanced oil recovery does not cause earthquakes. You are re-injecting, but you're more or less trying to maintain the pressure in your reservoir. And so then you generally don't get earthquakes, but there have been earthquakes caused by that. On top.
So have any predictive models been generated that show long-term, let's just say Oklahoma, with all of these earthquakes that are occurring, both frequency and, let's just go frequency. As far as the long-term effects to the geology, are we going to be talking subsidence here, or it sounds like the state's kind of been shaken into pudding. So
it's a good question. I showed you a little bit as far as what the USGS has been doing as far as forecasting, earthquake hazard sort of 1 year at a time. What the long-term impacts are is a really good question, and it's something that we're thinking about. But unfortunately, we're so busy responding to what's happening, we don't necessarily have time to really project sort of beyond this one year sort of time frame. As I mentioned, the sort of tight case of injection-induced seismicity, the largest earthquake happened over a year after injection stopped. So it is something that we really need to be thinking about. Turning off the wells is not, it's not a silver bullet. It's not going to fix everything. It will fix probably most things, but it will not fix everything. And so it's something that we really need to be thinking about. As far as subsidence is concerned, I wouldn't really anticipate that's going to be a problem, but I couldn't say for certain. Going to depend on the reservoir.
I have a question about
Okay. So, for
example,
so the question was about the Williston Basin in North Dakota. Why aren't there induced earthquakes in North Dakota? It's a very good question. There's been a limited amount of research done on what's happening in North Dakota, and it's probably some combination of geologic factors. Maybe the stresses aren't strong enough. You're not close enough to having an earthquake. Could be you don't have long enough faults. It could be your faults are not oriented correctly to produce earthquakes given the local stress field. Like I talked about with Oklahoma, we have this incredible fault map now, but 2 years ago we had 10 lines on the map. And so it's the same sort of situation for North. So without this very detailed information, it's really hard to answer that question. It's a really good question, and it's something that I think about a lot is, what makes North Dakota different from Oklahoma? If we can figure this out, we can probably control these earthquakes to some degree. So it's an important question. It's something we're working on.
I'm wondering if you know what the economic impact of negative economic impact in terms of all these earthquakes have been, and also in environmental regulation where it's often kind of a balance between the value of products that's kind of coming out, whatever it is, agriculture or energy or whatever, and the cost of regulation. What do you think is the best solution, and what do you think is the most likely solution?
as far as the cost of the earthquake, it's really hard for me to say. There has been a fair amount of damage, but no catastrophic damage as of yet. Question about regulations. It's very fortunate, as over at the USGS, we are a science agency, and regulations are not my responsibility. It's a very tough question, and certainly we spend time talking to the regulators, giving them advice on the science so they can understand what we're doing better. But that's really their decision on how to sort of choose this balance. I will say a little bit more about regulations. As I mentioned, the EPA sort of sets minimum standards for how you regulate injection wells in the United States. Their regulatory power has nothing to do with earthquakes. It comes from the Safe Drinking Water Act. And so they're pretty uncomfortable trying to put new regulations based on seismicity in. A number of states have taken action specific to seismicity, but the EPA has been very tentative as far as that. They did release that guidance document, but they really have not, they haven't put in any new rules or regulations.
Thank you.
it's interesting to see, you know, every state handles it a little bit differently.
So, in regards to that Safe Water Act that you mentioned, with the wastewater injection, is there any potential relationship to community water supply being harmed?
Can community water get harmed from wastewater injection? The short answer is yes. The probability is incredibly low. There are about 35,000 wastewater disposal wells that are active in the United States right now. I actually just read the first ever that I've seen documented case of drinking water affected by wastewater disposal. So yes, it can happen. The likelihood is very low. So you're asking how does the water, the co-produced water, how does that get to the injection well?
It's not the same water. So
the co-produced water, which is the main source of this wastewater that's disposed of, it's either trucked or taken in pipeline. You know, it really depends on the field. If the field is operated by one person or one company that owns all the injection wells, it's typically by pipeline. Oftentimes, there's mom-and-pop operations where they have one or two wastewater disposal wells. People will truck them off.
You mentioned before that maybe in Saudi Arabia there's less salt water produced in production wells. What factors would control how much salt water is produced? Things like the age of the reservoir, or control of the migration, or proximity to the salt zones, or something like that? What is that?
So it's really the geologic history that controls, you know, what the ratio of oil to salt water is, and that's going to have to do with sort of the age, how long that ocean has been sitting there, and how much sort of biological components. So I don't think there's an easy rule of thumb to do it. You know, you look at sort of the original plays like Texas, and you're looking at nearly 100% oil. But as time has gone on, the easy plays are less and less. The more difficult plays are more and more, and so you start getting more salt water. And so we're just sort of going. That's sort of where it's going. Question down here.
Three questions that are rather independent. I don't want to take everybody's time to ask all three at once. Only to do it once. When I looked at your map, that produced oil water. I noticed that the density of fault lines is relatively low where the quake reports were highest on that map. I also noticed, yes, that's one
question. So those lots of earthquakes up there, not a lot of fault.
Yes. Okay. The other second question for that question is it possible that the mere injection of the water generates faults?
Okay, so to answer the first part of your question, I have not actually ever noticed that until just now. That most of your earthquakes are happening where there aren't a lot of documented faults. I have a good answer for that, though. The Mississippi Lime and the Hutton, these are new formations. These are new plays. Working here in Oklahoma City and eastern Oklahoma, these are 100 plus year old plays. And so the documentation of what's going on there is going to be far better. And they're also, because they're old plays, industry is more likely to share information than they are in the new place where people are going. Now, the second question was about, can injection create faults? Yes and no. It's not going to be creating faults where you're going to be producing magnitude 3s, magnitude 4s, magnitude 5s. These are all occurring on pre-existing faults. A magnitude 4-5 earthquake, that's going to rupture, a few miles of fault. And you're just not going to be able to create that with the injection. There's got to be a plan of reconsideration.